that there is the soul mantra. This comes from the works of Alice Bailey. And the soul mantra is an invocation of your own soul. And the reason I'm showing this here is because it will make sense at the end of my talk. And we want to, we can actually just still our mind for a little bit and we can say the mantra. Right. Peace and silence. I am the soul. I am the light divine. I am love. I am will. I am fixed design. Okay, thank you. Now, the aim of the talk is to reveal insights into humanity's spiritual development and the path of discipleship, derived mostly from these books. Esoteric Astrology, Glamour, a World Problem, and the Rays and Initiations. Part one is about glamour, illusion, and maya, the obstacles the disciple must overcome to travel the path. Part two covers the development of soul consciousness through the mutable, fixed, and cardinal crosses of Esoteric Astrology. And I'll try and explain these. I'm not going to do like William Meader did, which is going into the infinite detail of it all. I'm just trying to give the big picture. So on we go. What is glamour? Glamour is a fusion of a false mental idea with a powerful emotion. Glamours exist in the planetary aura and in the auras of all humans. Two examples here, and they're really a little bit artificial. The glamour of personal identity, the idea, I'm a separated person in a world, the emotion is fear. And the second one is the glamour of conflict addiction. The idea, I'm threatened, and the emotion, anger. These two glamours don't need to be created by a desperate, frightened child. They both already exist in the child's aura, ready to be adopted and picked up from the planet's astral and mental planes. These two glamours are primal and they are part of the illusion of separation. I'm not mentioning the third one, which is the glamour of desire. Enough is enough. I'm just trying to get across a general idea. There are millions of glamours. There are personal glamours, national glamours, financial glamours. The list is endless. For instance, we can say a financial glamour might be a penny saved is a pound earned, or look after number one. Anyway, the personal self is mostly a mosaic made of these glamours which have been picked up from the astral plane. Each one is like a reflex. A glamour, when it's operating, is devoid of rational thought. People are capable of rational thought, but the majority of us tend to not use it. Instead, most of us stagger through life winging it with glamour, almost completely unconscious. And that really is true of most people. Eliminating glamour might enable us to think clearly and behave rationally, but there's more to it than that. The obstacles we face on the path of spiritual development are largely composed of glamour and its variations. Glamour is a fusion of astral and mental content. Illusions are mental or mental and etheric content. And maya is astral, mental and etheric. The ones that have etheric content are very difficult to overcome because there's actually energetics involved with those, whereas the others are just creating an illusion. The glamour of personal identity is an expansion of it. Very briefly, it's the root of all other glamours and creates the abyss of separation between the self and other, between human and divine. This is attachment to the formed human expression, the personality, including its physical form, the bodily appearance, the held image, and the emoting response in its roles. The illusion of personal identity creates unending desires, cravings, fear, doubt, neurotic thought, and a large range of sufferings in all parts of life. Ordinary human consciousness is generally exactly the same thing. Attachments to these desires really form all of the other glamours, in particular subjects in them. Closely related to the glamour of personal identity and almost as primal is the glamour of conflict addiction. Being in conflict with another has a hidden benefit, increasing the sense of separateness, independence, and uniqueness of the personality, intensifying its sense of self. Addiction to conflict begins as soon as the glamour of self-identity and is strongly instrumental in maintaining it. Conflict is provoked immediately, a threat is sensed, whether identified or not. And we all should be grateful if we're nowhere near the person because they'll lash out at someone. Provoking arguments, gossip, choosing sides in any area of controversy for the sake of the conflict itself is a hallmark of this glamour. And that's just another example of a glamour. The problem of glamour. To incarnate on planet Earth means immersion in a miasma of glamour, illusion, and maya that fills the etheric, astral, and mental planes of the Earth. The planetary miasma consists of the remnant ideas, emotions, and energy of billions of human beings on the astral, lower mental, and etheric planes. The major part is glamour and its variants. These memes survive by being picked up by the living and sent on. They are the equivalent of a computer virus which sabotages its host. The host in this case is the incarnate body and the attached soul. To be immersed in glamour is to believe many things uncritically, which have been inherited from the humans of the past. We all start this way when we're reborn. We can't avoid it. The Tibetan tells us a key point. The soul is taken in by glamour, illusion, and maya. And when it first incarnates, and after that, it remains trapped on this plane, thinking that it's a human being for incarnation after incarnation after incarnation. And my thoughts on this, this actually relates to pravritti and nivritti. At one point, spirit descended into matter, and that was part of the divine plan at that time. Now we have reached the turnover point and we're ascending back out of matter to spirit itself. So things have turned over. So now there's a way out for souls who are caught in that trap. And that's what we're going to talk about. So we'll go on to the ideas from Esoteric Astrology. We're now entering into the age of Aquarius and we're just leaving the age of Pisces. According to the Alice Bailey books, some of them anyway, by the way, Alice Bailey thought it was all going to happen in the 1980s, but it actually didn't happen until now with the impending age of Aquarius. So it's actually happening now, which is why I'm giving this talk now. It's actually happening now. Now, these are the esoteric properties of the signs. If you have, can everyone see the slide from down the back? I hope so. The properties of the signs, if you run your eye down the right-hand column, start off with six eyes and then six wings. So we can see that according to esoteric astrology, this is the evolution of the soul from the person into the group and ultimately to the oneness of all things. So that's the reason I put this here. Next one. These are the initiations and the rays and the various other things. I'm actually going to talk about the four initiations that are here. they're framed in Christian terms. Don't be put off by that. Bailey was writing for a Christian audience. The birth of the Christ is really the birth of unconditional love in the life of the disciple. When that occurs, that's counted as initiation one. And anyway, more about that later. The baptism of the Christ is the commitment of the disciple to the path. The transfiguration is the arising of the soul, what was called the soul's consciousness, but which is actually very difficult to see the difference between that and the touch of the monad. In other words, it's very much like spiritual enlightenment. And then we have the renunciation, which is the renunciation of the personality altogether. And so these things line up with things in the Indian tradition, I've got no doubt. Now, the reason I'm showing you this one is because of one of the properties of esoteric astrology, which is if you look at people who are on the mutable cross, who are completely unspiritual, they follow clockwise around the diagram. When in successive incarnations, they choose, they may not be continuous, but they have to choose something in a clockwise direction. But people who have already become spiritual, they follow it in the reverse direction. And we can see evidence of this. We have the age of Pisces, which is, and the age of Aquarius adjacent, but they're going the anti-clockwise direction. So that's simply the, shows the influence of esoteric astrology. Now, this is simply a list of the same things that we saw there. The that's right. I'll just go back to that one, because yes, the three crosses of esoteric astrology is, if we look at the cardinal signs, they are the right angle from the top, from Aries to Libra and Capricorn to Cancer. That's the cardinal cross, and the mutable cross is Pisces to Virgo and Sagittarius to Taurus. No, I've got it wrong. To Gemini, that is. You know, yeah. And the fixed cross is Aquarius to Leo and Scorpio to Taurus. Now we've got it right. Those are the three crosses, and they talk about that. They're nothing to do with a Christian cross. And this is, for those who like it, as shows the modality of the mutable cross is desire. And the ray is active intelligence here. The fixed cross has a modality of aspiration. Now, aspiration, in Bailey's terminology, means a transmutation of desire into desire to progress on the path. And that is a worthwhile change to desire, because it propels you forward. On the cardinal cross, it becomes what they call spiritual attraction. Spiritual attraction really means the same thing as synchronicity. And a synchronicity is something that happens without any logical reason for it, just out of the blue. What this means is someone who's on the cardinal cross has become spiritually awakened completely and no longer subscribes to the personal ego and its wishes, and therefore believes God is the doer of all that is done, not me. And what this means is, if something's going to happen to you, it just, God brings it, nobody else. Yeah. It means that if you're going to find people to teach, they'll turn up, and you won't have any hand in them appearing. If someone's going to help you or teach you, they will just turn up. This is not done by human agency. So that's the meaning of synchronicity, and that actually aligns very well. Now, this is just a disclaimer, this one. The personal self or ego, I say here that the consciousness of both people can be seen the sequence of thoughts in the parental language and feelings. If there are no thoughts or feelings, the person thinks there's nothing there. The person seeks external and internal validation from other people and seeks to interpret their world. I think, therefore I am, I'm quoting. It's the Descartes there. I think, therefore I am. For the purpose of this talk, I'll call this consciousness the mind-made self or the person. The part of our consciousness which is spiritually intuitive and inspired will be the focus of the rest of our talk. Now this, I will read all of this out because it's very hard to see down the back. And it's also put in English that is very stilted and comes from the 19th century. However, it's the exact words of the Tibetan who was channeled by Alice Bailey. Intuition is a comprehensive grip of the principle of universality, and when it is functioning, there is momentarily at least a complete loss of the sense of separateness. At its highest point, it is known as that universal love which has no relation to sentiment or to the affectional reaction, but is predominantly in the nature of an identification with all beings. Then is true compassion known. Then does criticism become impossible. Then only is the divine germ seen as latent in all forms. Intuition is light itself, and when it is functioning, the world is seen as light, and the light bodies of all forms become gradually apparent. This brings with it the ability to contact the light center in all forms, and thus again an essential relationship is established, and the sense of superiority and separateness recedes into the background. Intuition, therefore, brings with its appearance three qualities. Going on. Illumination, the light to which I refer, is that which irradiates the way. The intuition is therefore the recognition in oneself, not theoretically, but as a fact in one's experience, of one's complete identification with the universal mind, of one's constituting a part of the great world life, and of one's participation in the eternal persisting existence. Number two, understanding. This must be appreciated in its literal sense as that which stands under the totality of forms. It connotes the power of recession or the capacity to withdraw from one's age-long identification with form life. Three, love. It is that synthetic, inclusive grasp of the life and needs of all beings. I have chosen these two words with intent, which is the high prerogative of a divine Son of God to operate. It negates all that builds barriers, makes criticism, and produces separation. It sees no distinction, even when it appreciates need and produces in one who loves as a soul immediate identification with that which is loved. So we can get the ideas that are being transmitted here, although it's silted language. What he's describing here is the consciousness of the soul, as it's put later. And this is getting very close to an awakened being, yeah. Now we are starting with the actual story of the mutable cross. Now the mutable cross is occupied by beings who have no trace of spirituality in them at all, and it has been called the path of hidden light. And that's simply because nobody can work out what's going on in it. That's because everyone is controlled by the ego, and they don't seem to learn very much as time goes on. The average stay, I believe, according to the writings, on the immutable cross is 3,000 incarnations, and there's probably a lot who stay there a lot longer, very few that come out any sooner. Anyway, the soul has a beginning on the earth. The first incarnation happens, leading to desire and fear. The solar angel is there, but the person is unable to hear it. The soul experiences each life and learns over many lives. Glamour, illusion, and Maya are impenetrable. It is governed by them. And with these, everything is a reflex for you. People can think, but they don't do it very much. They're basically, someone lashes out at me, I'll lash out at him, basically. So this is a, it's very difficult to say anything much more about the mutable cross, except how you got into it and how you get out. After many lives, the idea the person needs other people and should look after them appears. When that arises, according to the Tibetan, the solar angel prompts the soul to reach out for the monad. And when this occurs, the soul is revolutionized, and recontacting the monad causes it to reach out and plant a seed of its own consciousness in the vehicles of the incarnated body. What this does is make that person a disciple, because the seed will grow and gradually influence the disciple with growing soul consciousness, which will appear in his life. The soul consciousness is not obvious. In order to find it, you have to look within yourself. And if you do that, you'll find it. Anyway, on to the next one. Now, hang on, I don't think I've missed something wrong here. Ah, mutable cross. That one's in the wrong place. Yeah, here we are. Now I've got the right one. Huh? Mutable cross. I'm going the wrong way. Ah, here we are. Now I'm in the right place. This is the fixed cross. It's the next one. And I say at the top, learning to be a soul, because that's actually what we're doing on the fixed cross. Work on service and dispelling glamour, and here is glamour again, leads to mastery of the astral plane and initiation one. That means the disciple has to work on his self-defeating behaviors and until he overcomes some of the glamour that is there. The result of reaching initiation one, you probably won't find these in the Indian tradition, I don't think. It's very likely in a lot of them that they only recognize initiation three as meaning anything. But this one, it results in the gift of unconditional love. When unconditional love appears in the person's life, that's the milestone. And they are getting close to it with the idea of personal responsibility. But it goes a little bit deeper. It means that the soul is growing in that person. Aspiration is really leakage from the soul's knowledge. And what's leaking out is knowledge of the life plan review, the last one that took place. And when that knowledge is there, then the disciple knows what he's supposed to be and how far he falls short of it. And this is the motivating force of aspiration, which is desire transformed into desire to proceed on the plan. And without that, I actually think most people wouldn't have gone on. They need it. Anyway, more service, dispelling more glamour, and mastering the mental plane leads to initiation two. And the gift is the beginning of the intuition. And the intuition, remember, is the beginning of the soul consciousness, as in an overt way. And I'll say more about this on the next page. Work on more service and dispelling Maya and illusion this time, which is harder, leads to initiation three, also called the transfiguration. This is the beginning of actual soul consciousness. After reorientation completes, the disciple is now a conscious soul. That's a big ask, but anyway, we'll move on to the next slide.
Can I ask you a question about the last one? Just about how many lives there might be in that one? There was 3,000 in the other one. How long did you spend in this one?
Oh, it varies a lot. Some of them may only spend a few lives. Some might actually do all three initiations in the same life. Some might spend dozens of them. It really depends on individual factors. How hard is it going to be for some people to get over glamour? Oh, there's a lot of factors there. But it's quite frequent that people go through all the first four initiations in one life. One actually leads to another, but most people actually take a few to get through, but they're not going to be stuck there for 3,000 years. Anyway. Yeah, that's where I was. Now, this is the Cardinal Cross. Now, there's only one initiation on the Cardinal Cross, and it is difficult to describe. And so that's right on the first line. It says, did I drop my thing, did I? Thanks, mate. Pardon me for dropping my thing. No, anyway, what I say is synchronicity, which is what we just been discussing before, leads to life equals service, which means that it's service because everything you do is God's will. And it leads ultimately to group work, which is means you unite with other souls in doing common work. And where that leads is to initiation four, which is the renunciation of the person or any trace of it that's left in you, because that actually is not conducive. The other thing that happens when you reach initiation four is you have entered the Buddhic plane and you cannot get in there with a personality. In fact, it is actually incompatible with what's happening there completely. So, anyway, there's my description of the soul consciousness is here, and the disciple is awake and alert, but prefers to remain in a state of deep peace and silence. There's a deep, quiet inner happiness that fills existence. The world is seen as light, and the point of light in other beings is easily seen. The disciple is a node of unconditional love and deep care for all beings. Oneness with the universal awareness is always there. Knowledge is in your beingness. It comes when it wants to. Other souls are within you. They're not outside of you. Working to implement the divine plan is every awakened disciple's business. So we are cooperating. In reality, what the real truth is, the oneness of all things. The mind likes to break it apart into individuals doing this job or that job, but in reality, that's not real. At the bottom, I say, the person's thoughts are still there, but the soul ignores them. The person is no longer in control after initiation three. The person is used by the soul as an instrument of contact with others to further the divine plan. So the ability of the personality to interact with other people is used as a spiritual instrument by the soul. That's what that means. And the third thing, the disciples can still be provoked into the person mode, but soon reverts to soul consciousness. It means that if somebody does an outrageous act, they might actually get hit back. but it won't stay that way. Even the Dalai Lama said that he was asked, what will you do if you saw someone attacking a woman on the bus? And he said, it's permissible to strike him very hard with one's umbrella. So, yeah, even he could be triggered out of it. That sort of implies it. Where you want to be is there, nowhere else. Anyway, I have more things to say about this issue with initiation three. These are the notes on initiations two and three. there's something that happens here that seems to be to happen in a lot of people's experience, and that is this. If we look back at the previous slide, which I will go back to now, I think the second previous one, back. Initiation 2 and 3 we have on here. It says the gift is the beginning of the intuition, and the intuition, as we know, is full-blown soul consciousness. Now, it also says that contact with the intuition is sporadic until initiation 3. And if we go back up again, that's what I'm trying to explain here. Soul consciousness after initiation 2 is like a thunderbolt that gives the disciple a taste of being the soul for a short time. The change of consciousness is totally unexpected. The person is terrified. It knows it will lose dominance. As far as the personality is concerned, something completely unexpected is marched in through the door. And it can, the person can tell it's the white liner in the body. And it's terrified, all right, because it thinks it's going to be kicked out permanently. It only lasts a day or two, however. Then the person wins the fight because it controls the mind. The personality, the mind-made self, is an expert on thoughts, and it can manipulate the thoughts. It can actually even go, na, 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 block the consciousness of the soul out. it'll find a way, especially because it has under its control etheric glamours and etheric maya. Until those things are broken, the soul cannot take control. Anyway, if you're going to go through initiation 3, you have to defeat these glamours before you get the carrot. So therefore, anyway, as I say here, the person wins the fight and suppresses it. The disciple is desperate for it to return and will leave no stone unturned, because having just experienced what amounts to enlightenment and having lost it, that's really intolerable. and the struggle between the disciple and the person continues until after initiation 3. So I say at the bottom there, it'll finally be resolved with permanent soul consciousness after they've gotten rid of the glamour. But it takes time. There's other things that happen with this transition, and that is there can be a crisis of reorientation. And by that I mean it's possible for them to actually win the prize and actually continue in the personality consciousness, because they're using the old paradigm, because they haven't really grasped the nature of the new one. The new one is, the old one was thought and thinking. The new one is being. Everything is contained in your being, and only within you will you find it. And it's possible for people to be stuck in a crisis of reorientation for more than one life after this. And that really, to me, is an appalling event. But I believe it's happened a few times. Anyway, I think we've covered that bit. Now I'll just go back to the next. Hang on. Ah, yes, soul consciousness. I'm trying to explain this a little bit. Throughout the disciple's life, consciousness has been a mixture of soul and personality consciousness. These two can coexist because knowledge for the person consists of thoughts and feelings in the head. The person thinks that the absence of thoughts means that nothing is there. So therefore, it doesn't notice the soul consciousness living with it in the same person. The person thinks that the absence of thoughts means that there's nothing there. It never looks within. The soul consciousness does not think at all. Rather, its knowledge and activity exists on a higher plane, not perceptible to the person. The disciple, however, looks within and is closely linked. For the soul, everything is part of its being, and as a disciple, It's part of your being as a disciple as well. And you can, by looking within, you can find lots of stuff. You can find out who you really are or what you really are. Now to the next one. One of the soul's abilities is discernment, which is the ability to discern truth about something. One way of dissolving glamour is to hold it in the light of the soul. Focusing this on your thoughts is very revealing, provided you've got enough soul consciousness for it. The person is a false self who took up residence in the body and mind of the life, and it's really composed of a collection of glamour, illusion, and maya. Its aim is to survive and to defeat its enemies. Without the monad-connected soul, it's selfish and incapable of unconditional love and compassion. Initiation 4 is the renunciation of the person. After initiation 4, soul group work begins in earnest on the buddhic plane, and the person is just not compatible. The mind-made personal self is yesterday's paradigm. In the age of Aquarius, the rightful owner of the body and its mind is the soul. Oh no, I'm going the wrong way. Ah, yes, here we are. Soul consciousness in the age of Aquarius. On the mutable cross, before the path of the disciple, interactions of souls was like a billiard table. Persons collided with each other and sometimes were shoved down a pocket. All took part in endless wars of all against all and combinations of all these things. This created many karmic bonds between the souls involved. Most souls take thousands of incarnations to reach the fixed cross, so all of us belong to a few souls. Most souls, like Roman soldiers, form cohorts or groups of souls who incarnate together. A group may have originally had bonds of mutual hatred or vengeance. As they evolved through the mutable, fixed, and cardinal crosses, these bonds have evolved into bonds of unconditional love and shared purpose. The ascended masters in the hierarchy are made up of soul groups working together. Their goal is to create the age of Aquarius, which will result in all humans on earth living in soul consciousness and the arrival of heaven on earth. As we progress through the cardinal cross to initiations 3 and 4 and beyond, it will be our job to join with the masters in the hierarchy. We will share bringing on the new paradigm. Now, that one. We are getting to the end of my talk now. I'm going to introduce the Rainbow Bridge here, which is related to the Soul Mantra, which I said at the beginning of the talk. And I'm going to show you, That'll do it. Gone. Okay. Now. Hang on. I don't know where that is. Here we are. Did I get it there? Yes, I did. Hang on. I'll just try and bring that up. There we go. Now, a bit more. Am I in there? I don't know. Did that increase in size? I don't know if you can see these. Hey? Hey? I've got something. Where's cancel? Oh, yeah, okay. I know now I see why I'm having a problem. I'm going to find the mouse. Is the aura before. You can see all of these objects in the person's aura. These are the glamour and other things which are, inhabit the aura as seen by a clairvoyant. And this is after the clearing by the tools that I'm going to introduce. And if you can get rid of that, you're going to do better on the spiritual path. And I'll just move down through that document a bit more. I don't know where I am, that's my problem.
Just on the right side.
Ah, there I am. Yeah, now what I want to do is scroll down. Now this is a how-to booklet. And this how-to booklet was published in 1981 when the authors of this subject thought it was just time for the change, and it actually wasn't. What's happened is the book is now out of print since 1989, but now is the time when it's needed. Luckily, I found these things on the internet, and anyone who's interested in these things, I've got the internet addresses of where you can get your own copies from. And these things are definitely worth doing. I'll just return to my talk again. I've got some more information on this.
It's a very powerful argument. It's a very powerful five pages of information if you follow it.
Oh, look, Tony, I've got this is the phase one clearing that I'm showing you now. I've also got the phase two clearing, and there's been a lot of development in the US. There is now a phase two soul star clearing, which you can get through in a matter of weeks instead of the 3 or 4 years that the word-based one took. And so that was really so hard. The word clearing, it was just endless. Hey? And with the word clearing, it was what actually happened. You just repeated all these different keywords into the same sentence. And when it struck a glamour, it would explode. But they just use the channel wide. Except they do it 12 times instead of 3. And then they put through the whirlwind at the end of it to get rid of the debris. And you've got to do that for about 8 weeks. And that clears the lot out. But that stuff is so hard to remove. It's all the etheric stuff. It requires soul energy to destroy those things, and a lot of it. So this is something that is very hopeful.
I've actually developed a course on it a number of times.
Yeah, anyway. Yeah. Anyway, I'll go back to my talk. No, it's not working because I haven't put it on yet. How's that? Now, see if I can tilt up and down on this thing. Yeah, there we are. No, we can look. It was Josephine and Norman Stevens who were the authors of this stuff. Josephine Stevens was the secretary of Alice Bailey in the 1940s, and her husband later was a director of the Lucis Trust. So there are people who are right there. This book is the source of those techniques. And it was actually created in 1944. And the next page. Oh, I'm going backwards. Yes, Josephine and Norman were members in 1944 of an experimental group of disciples who were convened by the Tibetan, channeled by Alice Bailey. The phase one and phase two techniques were created and tested with the group, and later refined by the authors in the 80s, just before it was published. So that's where it came from. It has a lot of credit. And there's the mantra. The mantra works with invocation and evocation. The invocation is, say the mantra with sincere intent. And the evocation is, the soul responds by placing the soul star 6 inches above your head. The soul star is then controlled by creative visualization to move it in various parts of your body and do the clearing. And it's incredibly effective.
What was created first, the soul, or is the soul created by someone just being born at the body?
No. In reality, in the universe, there is only the one awareness, which is the creator of everything. All else is illusion. All else is illusion.
So the soul is an illusion
too? The soul is an illusion too. But the soul isn't really an illusion. The consciousness of a person who has the soul consciousness that I described is actually part of the one awareness and very close to it. That is very close to the consciousness of a human being who's in contact with the monad. Very close indeed. And in reality, the idea that the soul knows that other souls are within it amounts to the same thing. If other souls are within you, then there really isn't any soul. Okay.
This thing which you're talking about is really has no depth to it, because if it's all one, what are you describing?
What I'm describing is actually indescribable, because the human mind has no capacity to understand it, and it just is. What it's an alternative to is the ordinary human consciousness, which is very limited.
It's unity consciousness.
Huh? Unity consciousness. Yes, we're talking. Yes, exactly. It is. Well, you're already. Yes, we are that one. And the knowledge of that is what it is. It doesn't matter what you frame it as. It doesn't really matter. Once you have reached that point, you know it, but it's very hard to transfer it to someone else, because other people don't understand it. There is no there's no way. I mean, basically, if we go back to the days of Socrates, the solipsists were right. It's not possible to communicate your knowledge to another person, because they will understand it only in accordance with their concepts, not yours. And so, therefore, it seems like each one of us is an island. And the Buddha wouldn't disagree with that idea either. It's unknowable. It's impossible to transfer your idea to another person. That's simply because there's a problem with being a separated being. It isn't real. It's an illusion. The only reality is the divine awareness which fills the universe and makes everything interaware. It's the creator of the universe, but being in the universe is not of it. So there we have it. And it's any more questions?
Yeah.
Yes.